You may be seated. Thank you, Mom. You did such a good job. She's always so careful not to catch the plant on fire, and she keeps the fire lit the whole time. That's a big responsibility. I think she's grown about 5 inches since she started doing that. So let the people say amen. So much. I'm looking forward to our worship today, and we have a good crowd here, even though it's terrifically hot outside, and I'm so grateful for that. Let's open our worship this morning with just a word of prayer. We're so grateful, oh Heavenly Father, to be within your midst. We pray that your Holy Spirit will inspire us to be your people, your servants, your workers, your disciples. We pray for those who could not be with us today, O Lord, and for those that do not know you. We pray for our world, for our community, for our leaders. We pray for those who have no one to pray for them. And we ask that as we go throughout this next hour, that each and every one of us will feel your comfort and your care in our own life. We ask these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Well, we still have FM radio station 91.3 going, and if you're joining us on the radio, in the parking lot, or at home on FM 91.3, we welcome you and acknowledge you and know that you are a part of this service. If by chance you couldn't make it to a morning worship today, and you are watching this video on our Facebook page by YouTube, I want to welcome you and pray that the power of the Holy Spirit is with you. We acknowledge you in worship. We're going to begin our worship today in our United Methodist hymnal. And I was thinking the other day, for those of you who don't like to look up the whole time, feel free to use your book. You don't have to just read the words on the screen. Use the book. We're going to stand as able and sing the first and second verse of Freely, Freely. That's number 389. So we will stand as able for Freely. Freely. any kind of little kind of white elephant gifts is what we have for prizes. So that's something that we share together. I want to jump down to the little free library. As you can see all across the altar, our two young confirmands helped me take our books that we have for the little free library and lay them all out. The Methodist Church globally is helping to make everyone aware that reading is a valuable and needed thing for every individual to take part in. And so we are offering these books for you to take home and give away. If the children read them and want to send them back, that's fine. But we have all of these books available. So before you leave today, if you know any child in your community or your family, if you'd like to give them some books to read, the summer is long without reading, unless you're sitting in front of the TV all day. And so we want to promote reading. In that venue, you might have noticed that our stage platform has been returned out in the back parking area. Mr. Lee Walker was kind enough to return it from the disaster response team who used it last year for a fundraiser. I had him put it underneath our grove of pecan trees out here, three or four trees. We are going to use that for a reading patio. We're going to put up another little free library there. We have one that kind of got vandalized, so we're going to put it back up here behind our property, and we're going to use that reading area for anybody in the community. You might not be aware, but people walk through our campus all the time, 24 hours a day. We find wrappers, you know, and candy, Coke bottles, and stuff like that. And so we know that people are walking through the campus. Wouldn't it be nice to have a shady spot to sit down, a safe, secure spot? And we'll have reading available in our weatherproof box there. I'm writing a grant that I'm going to send off in August that will supply two patio tables and solar lighting for that area. So I'm hoping that that will turn out. But if not, we'll just actively continue to try to get that going for a reading patio. On the fifth Sunday of next month, both churches will join here at Prescott, Midway and Prescott at 11 o'clock. We're going to have a singing service, and Donna and I are going to trade off of playing the songs, and we'll have an opportunity to just sing for probably 30 minutes, and then we're going to have potluck with both churches joining together. So I hope that you'll be able to participate in that. And lastly, Confirmation Sunday has been set for July 17th. Landon Harvey and Parker Grimes both are going to be confirmed, and any others that might at that time feel that they want to make a profession of faith or join the church or be baptized. And so we're preparing for that. They did a lot of hard work for me this last week. We were able to feed the homeless. We were able to actually go into the places that were of need. We coordinated with Barry Marks at the GAP, the UAMS GAP office. He gave us 10 boxes of food to distribute. They loaded and unloaded. They've done everything. And so I really want y'all to support them. And let's give, Landon's here today. Let's give him a hand for the work that they've done. And that is a testimony to who you are, that you have children that are interested in being like you, Christians. All right, are there any other announcements? I've got a couple of concerns. Bob Kopman was back in the hospital this week with some health concerns that have been taken care of. And I think he's going to be headed home back this week, probably today. Johnny Jones is doing wonderful after a minor surgery that he had this last week. Mr. James Barnes has had some skin cancers, and he's got an upcoming surgery. We're thinking of you, James. And we have several people that are going through therapy, physical therapy, knee problems, shoulder problems, recovery problems, and some concerns that we've too many to list, but you know who you are. Everybody has someone in their life that needs prayer. And so I want to lift them up. We also have people that are working out in the heat. And I see people working on the highway. And I don't know about you, but every time I pass a person holding a sign that says stop and go, I want to hand them a bottle of water or a Route 44 drink. I feel so bad for them. But hopefully they have an icebox or something that they can get drinks from. There are a lot of people that are working outside these days, and we want to remember them, especially people with livestock. I know Julia works with livestock, and I pray that we are all able to take breaks and stay cool. So let's go to the Lord in prayer again for our concerns. I am lifting up to you, O Heavenly Father, our needs, which you know even better than we know. For you knitted us and formed us in the womb, and you know what we are made of. So we pray to you for healing concerns. We pray to you for those that we have lifted up by name, but more importantly, those that are not named and engraved upon our heart. I pray for those, O Heavenly Father, who have no one to visit them, who don't have air conditioning or a fan, who might be living in persecution. For the world is in dire need of your healing, O God. We lift up to you our needs at this time. Amen. All right, let's see. Our next hymn is Jesus Calls Us. And this is the theme of our service today. Jesus Calls Us. And we're going to sing 1, 2, and 5. You may remain seated. This is a high song. Okay.
Candy.
That's right, got some candy.
And I have some.
others, especially with learning. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, Marla, thank you for coming down. At this time, let us have worship through giving. We pray that we are continually grateful for all you've given us. Amen.
So far, my heart is so free.
in the atmosphere right before he dies. When the days drew near for him to be taken up, he set his face to go to Jerusalem. And he sent messengers ahead of him. On their way, they entered a village of the Samaritans to prepare for his arrival. But they did not receive him because his face was set towards Jerusalem. When his disciples, James and John, saw this, they said, "Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them?" But he turned and rebuked them, and they went on to another village. As they were going along the road, someone said to him, "I will follow you wherever you go." And Jesus said to him, "Foxes have holes, and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." To another he said, "Follow me." But he said, "Lord, first let me go and bury my father." And Jesus said to him, "Let the dead bury their own dead. But as for you, go and proclaim the kingdom of God." Another said, "I will follow you, Lord, but let me first say farewell to those at my home." And Jesus said to him, "No one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God." The word of God and the people of God. Thanks be to God. Well, this scripture reminds me of the rural connection that I have in my home in Cross County, Arkansas, Wynn, Arkansas. It's in the northeast corner up by Memphis. And it's a farm community with plowed fields and big John Deere tractors. Lots of mosquitoes. You can look across acres and acres of rice, corn, wheat, cotton, soybeans, milo. The rows are straight and never ending. The tractors are able to plant and plow up to 16 rows at a time for an amazing return of produce. And the beauty of the field lies in the repetitive nature of the roads and irrigation that flood the field with crystal clear water coming from the wells. Now, our last line of scripture completes the illustration that Jesus used to describe varying allegiance to his divine position. No one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God. Now Jesus sets the tone of the dedicated believer pitted against the indecisive believer who is not committed to anything. No one, Jesus says, who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God. Now that's pretty harsh if you ask anyone who isn't aware of plowing with a hand plow. Now if you don't understand the value of this farming connection, I'll tell you exactly what it means. If you are plowing with an animal on lead line, you must walk in straight rows and move forward without wavering. If you so much as turn your head and look back, your shoulders turn, your arms follow, and your mules follow, and you have just messed up your rows. You must stay focused on the job at hand, or you'll end up with rows that are wavy, curvy, jagged, or even non-existent from an unexecuted hand at the plow. As a result, water will not flow well, plowing the middles will not be possible, harvesting is a headache, and the entire process is compromised because the person guiding the plow was distracted from their purpose. They weren't 100% focused. Now, Jesus used these farming illustrations because he was talking to people who understood these kinds of examples. They were people who lived hand to mouth. You know what I mean? They plowed the rocky soil with oxen. To harvest, the ox would pull a heavy wooden sledge called a trigulum, and studded underneath this sledge were jagged flint rock to break down the grain when they harvested. Agriculture was a way of life that was harsh and necessary for survival. But on this day, Jesus, as a teacher, was inviting the common man, the sunburned man, the uneducated man, to open their mind, use their imagination, and put themselves in the story to understand exactly how this affected them personally. The entire scripture that we just read tells us to be devoted to Jesus as Lord. You must be devoted in every aspect of your life. Every aspect, everything you do. I'm going to change directions here. If you have ever been around anyone who is OCD, obsessive compulsive, you probably understand the aspect of devoted in every aspect of your life. Because a person with OCD will take their compulsion into every area that they are in. Nothing is off limits. Now I tell you this because my daughter and granddaughter have a cleaning compulsion. And they will clean everything in sight, including your house, while they're there. My granddaughter Jessie cleans my entire house every time she visits. I like for her to visit. She gets to the house and the first thing she does is opens my refrigerator. Oh, nanny, everything's expired. She pulls up the trash can and I'm thinking, I can still eat that. She is compulsive about cleaning in every area. You might know a compulsive eater. They have snacks in the vehicle. They have snacks in their office desk. They have snacks in their bedside table. They don't want to be caught without a snack if they find themselves wanting a snack. Some of you may know someone who's obsessed with work. You probably don't see them very often. They're always at the office, or their head is down when they bring their work home. I tell you this because being devoted in every aspect of your life means exactly this. You are always aware of your devotion to Jesus. It's a common thread in your life. You wake up devoted. You're devoted throughout the day. You're devoted when you go to bed. Nothing should be more important than your heavenly goal of kingdom destination. Life should be ordered around the love of Christ, and all other things fall into place after that. Now, in this reading, Jesus tells a man, "Follow me." But the man says, "Lord, first I must go and bury my father." And Jesus harshly says, "Let the dead bury their own dead. As for you, go and proclaim the kingdom of God." Now this seems harsh, especially if you have recently buried someone who is important to you. But in this situation, Jesus is speaking to a man whose father has not died yet. And this man is suggesting that he wait an indefinite amount of time until his father passes away. And then, after taking care of all the details of such a thing, then he will follow Jesus. Not now, as Jesus suggests, but later when things have slowed down a bit. The man may have also been considering his claim to inheritance. He didn't want to be anywhere except at the bedside waiting for the moment of financial benefit. Regardless of the reason, this man was hesitant in following Jesus. He was saying, "I'll get back to you later." His priorities were out of order, and Jesus recognized this. It is still our primary objective. expected as Christians to heed his call of discipleship. His call to follow me is still one of urgency and hope. We must look forward with our eye on the goal, and he will make our paths straight as a road in farming. What do you have in your life that is distracting you from the most important devotion of following Jesus? You know, there are many things in life that a person may invest in: stocks, bonds, IRAs, gold, property. And if you are a financier, you probably look at your investments online every day to see if you've gained or lost. But our investment in this church is one of a long future investment. Remember, we are enjoying the benefits of our forefathers and fathers. They saved. They planned. They built this church for the sake of following Christ in this community in the 1930s throughout the Depression. And we continue that same thread of dedication so that our children's children will continue the devotion to Christ as those gone before them. But something is missing. The church used to be a place where every family took part in the primary purpose of the church. You might remember there being Sunday school for every age. Decisions were made right after worship. They rung a bell and everybody said what they wanted to do. If someone had a great need, the church members took it upon themselves to help out or lend a hand, usually pass the plate a second time for a love offering. If someone lost their husband or wife, the church ladies prepared food and took it to their house. They didn't have to be a member. If you're very old, you might remember MYF for the youth. Or if you had a Baptist background, you might have went to Sunbeams. The important thread here is that church and the worship of God through community and family were a necessary part of walking in faith. Baptism was a rite of passage. Marriage was a sacred institution of holy ordinance given to us by God. And the Holy Scripture is the instruction book for life. I remember getting a pin on me for perfect attendance. Each Sunday school class that graduated into the next level was paraded out in front of the congregation and promoted. It was called Promotion Sunday. And every person over age 25 was expected to teach a class or attend a class without question when needed. The Sunday school superintendent counted everyone in the class and put it on a blackboard for everyone to see each Sunday. Did we gain or lose? If someone was missing, everybody said, "What happened to so-and-so? Why weren't they here today?" And everybody called them to see what was going on. Now, I know these are outdated 64-year-old memories, but it seems that we have lost the drive to keep our eye on the goal of living in step with God's purpose. Are we really following the call? Where are the families? Where are the teachers? Where are the leaders of what we know is the most important part of our daily life? Why are people staying home instead of attending church? Why are people allowing their children to sleep in, opt out, or take part only if it's convenient with all the other things going on? What about the role models we are expected to offer to those who do not know Christ? What about the expectation we place on ourselves and those who have shared this amazing responsibility of being disciples of Christ in Nevada County? Friends, we are called to a higher purpose because he said, "Follow me." You've probably seen that old commercial back in the 1970s. A child follows in the actual footsteps of his father. A tiny shoe is miniaturized in that large boot step of a father. And at the end of the trail, the father is lighting up a cigarette, and the small boy looks on with anticipation of the day he will be just like his father. Friends, friends, we have an awesome opportunity to lead our community and beyond towards the goal that is given to us by Jesus. To focus on the way we live and die that will honor our Lord and who claims us each one as his own children. We are following his footsteps in our daily walk of discipleship. A few weeks ago, I placed a sheet of paper in the bulletin that listed 10 ways for a Christian to be in ministry. There are all kinds of possibilities for a person to actively demonstrate their discipleship to Christ as Lord and Savior. The Bible tells us that we are to devote ourselves to good works, to help in cases of urgent need, and to be fruitful. Take a look outside these walls. If we look around, we find that our world is in dire need of God's hope. And if we proclaim to be Christians, it should be our joy to minister to the lost, to that one sheep out of the 99. Colossians 3 reminds us, whatever we do, work heartily for the Lord, and not for men. So our faith in Christ encourages us to be in ministry to the world for Christ's sake, not our own. It is with great concern that we find ourselves in the void of outreach and ministry in our community and in our world. I've been asked by some of you, why don't we have children's Sunday school class anymore? Well, I'm going to tell you the reason. Although I have had one person volunteer to teach a Sunday school, children's Sunday school class before church, we sadly don't have consistent attendance to merit having a class. How would you feel if you planned the lesson and no one showed up? If we have a class, we need people to attend the class every single Sunday. We can have one if the youth attend the class. I've also been asked why we don't have a Bible study class for this church. I'll tell you why. We need leaders. We need a dedicated group to participate. People who really want to learn about the Bible and take a study seriously on a weekly basis. We can have a Bible study. If you want to lead a class and attend a class, maturity of faith is a vital step to discipleship. Why don't we have a big choir, you ask? You need a choir leader to have a choir. You need people to sing if you want a choir. We can have a choir with robes and anthems and cantatas and special music, have a director, and come to practice. We're only able to do what you, the church, is willing to do. Why don't we have a youth group meeting every week or a vacation Bible school? Well, you need several volunteers who will coordinate events, plan lessons, organize food, plan activities, make sure there are enough adults to supervise, possibly pick up and drop off you on your day off. We have a great facility. If you want to plan and participate in youth ministry, we have you. They'll come. We can have a youth group if you want to lead it and make sure that the youth are here. At some point a few years back, this church participated in Ozark Mission Project. You even still have a little money left in a line item that paid for you to go on a mission project. We haven't had anyone go in the last 7 or 8 years. But we have currently youth and the ability to go. With your leadership and devotion, it could happen. Why don't you get that up? We have an amazing facility here at our church. So much space to share the good news. We have a library, an art room, a classroom for drama and storytelling. We have a youth fellowship building with a great atmosphere for learning. We can add anything you possibly want or use for a vital church ministry except the leadership of it. It's time to figure out why you are here. You may be thinking, I'm not a teacher. I'm not a singer. I don't read well. I'm just not a leader. The Bible tells us that God said to Moses that he needed to preach and speak to the Pharaoh. And Moses was not eager for the job. The book of Exodus records that he finally said, "Oh, my Lord, I'm not an eloquent speaker, neither heretofore since thou spoken to thy servant, but I am slow of speech and of a slow tongue." Then the Lord said, "Who made a person's mouth? Who can make someone deaf or not able to speak? Who can make a person blind? Who can make a person able to see? I am the one. I am the Lord, so go. I will be with you when you speak. I will give you the words to say. The Lord prepares those he leads to do the work of the kingdom." So I ask you, are you attending for attendance sake, possibly looking for an attendance pin on your belt? Or are you actively involved in the sharing of the gospel? Because we will never change the world by going to church. We will only change the world by being the church. So how can we demonstrate our love for Christ by being the church? While speaking to the young confirmands at class last week, I was sharing with them what it means to be a member of this congregation, the body of Christ. We talked about using our gifts, sharing our wealth, serving in ways that are needed and necessary, taking time to pray, and most importantly, being present. And Landon Hardy said, "Being present means to show up." I think he understood the assignment. It is a well-known proverb of modern day, known as Pareto principles, that says 20% of the people do 80% of the work. We've got about 50 here today. That means that 10 of you are doing the work of all 50. What if 100% of the people did 100% of the work? Wouldn't that be amazing? Wouldn't we increase the kingdom of God by 80% by your deliberate effort? I'm closing now because I know it's getting long. I read a quote by W.E. Du Bois that addresses this very issue, and it reads, "We should measure the prosperity of a nation not by the number of millionaires, but by the absence of poverty, the prevalence of health, the efficiency of the public schools, and the number of people who can and do read worthwhile books." These are astute observations, and we find the USA fails miserably if we judge our nation by this rule of thumb. But what if we change this quote to read like this? We should measure the effectiveness of a church not by the number of members, but by the alleviation of poverty, the hope of health, the instruction of the Word of God, and the number of people who participate in the mission of the church. If we judged our church by this rule, we still fail miserably. Doesn't that seem to make sense for a body of Christ to embrace the community around them in spreading the good news and acts of mercy? If we are to do the will of God with what he has blessed us with and gifts and opportunities, we must step up the pace of our willingness and activity. I don't want to face our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ at the gate of heaven and hear him tell anyone, "I knew you not." As faithful disciples of Jesus Christ, we are about the work of the Lord. So let us pay attention to the urging of the Holy Spirit and get about the business of the Lord. Let us follow Christ to our eternal destination and meet our family. Amen. We're going to close with number 701. That hymn is "When We All Get to Heaven." Not just us. All the world gets to heaven as we stand for number 701. When we all get to heaven, we're going to sing the first and fourth verse, "Stand as Able." Don't forget, at the end of the service, I'd love for you to come down and get some books to share with others. Thank you. always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face, the rain fall soft upon your fields, and until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of his hand. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, go in peace. Amen.